Today I'm going to tell you all my flexible PCB engineering secrets, which are all based on mistakes I've made. Let's begin. Let's say you have this cool concept you've been thinking about all week long. How are you going to determine if the PCB needs to be flexible or a 4-4? I usually determine this based on the project's mechanics and if there's multiple boards. Imagine you want to sell thousands of this new project of yours. Adding wires or connector could add up the cost, as you're probably going to have to pay someone to hand solder those wires or hook up those connections. So it probably would be cheaper to have two boards into one and integrate the harness into the flex. But obviously this depends on your quantity, so you have to make your calculations. Eliminating the wires is not the only advantage, because you can also stack them and simplify the mechanics. But as my YouTube channel has proven, simplifying the mechanics is not that simple, because if not done right, flexible PCBs can create new additional mechanical problems. First rule is that you always need to use a stiffener. A stiffener is a cheaper alternative to flex-rigid PCBs, so it basically keeps the electronics region safe while other regions get flexy. It can be a piece of FR4 metal or plastic that the manufacturer can integrate with your design to prevent areas from bending. Unless your electronics needs to be super lightweight, I would avoid the 0.1mm thick plastic, as I found it's still a little bit bendy. These thin stiffeners are more intended for connectors, but I still find them very useful for my tiny robots. This way gives you the option of adding a stiffener on both the top and bottom layer. They don't usually charge you extra for this, so basically you don't have any excuses not to use them. They are defined by adding new mechanical layers and can be made in any shape. If you don't want to use a stiffener, you can also add your own mechanical supports, maybe like a PCB, a 3D printed part, or something like that. But you need to be super careful while attaching your board, because you'll be risking stressing or breaking the soldering joints. A very useful feature here can be adhesive, which the manufacturer allows you to specify so that it can be added underneath your board. The next thing you need to look out for is through-hole components. Given that flexible PCBs can be as thin as 0.1mm, through-hole pads are not going to rigidly support the pins. Any type of flex can easily break the pads. There are some other solutions like teardrops and tie downs, which can provide some additional stability and prevent breakage. So my suggestion here is to try and avoid single row through hole components. I think you can get away with this when you have multiple rows, because the component will be more rigid in place, but when possible I prefer to use surface mount. My last suggestion related to design has to do with corners. It's not that big of a deal, but when you can, try to avoid any sharp corners and instead use like a little fillet. This will make it less vulnerable, as it prevents it from tearing up. Another thing I've learned is that if you want to make a flexible region less stiff, you can just remove the solder mask. This will obviously make it thinner and more delicate, but the results are interesting. This little trick can be really handy for multi-layer boards, as the more layers you have, the thicker the PCB is. I will talk in more detail about this feature in one of my upcoming videos, so make sure you subscribe. Another way to reduce the stiffness is by reducing the width of the flex tails and making hatched planes instead of solid ones. I also forgot to talk about folding. From some experiments I made last year, I found that you can actually fold a PCB in half without breaking the copper. I don't recommend doing this unless it's some basic prototype that needs to be folded once or twice in its entire lifetime. If you want something more safe, you can use this flexible PCB hinge, where part of the board is folded and the signals are safe in the bendable region. As a general guideline, you should always have a minimum bend radius that is 10 times larger than the thickness of the PCB. When it comes to manufacturing, you also need to be aware of some hiccups. With my PCB coils, I found a problem with the repeatability of the etching process, which varies the track resistance. So this might be less accurate than if you had to manufacture an FR4 PCB with specific standards. Over the years, I also noticed some defects with the quality of the silkscreen. There is an actual difference between the silkscreen of the black and yellow solder mask. The silkscreen of the yellow coverlay is completely solid, but my manufacturer makes it by hand, which means that it can be offsetted. The silkscreen of the black one is made by a machine, so the alignment is better, but for some reason it does not have a solid mark. To go around this, I asked my manufacturer to make two passes when using black coverlay, which totally solved the problem. The last tip I have for you is about soldering. Flexible PCBs are made from a polyamide material, and PCBWay raises their temperature to around 260 degrees. This means that when soldering, we cannot exceed this temperature. If we ignore this, the PCB can get all puffed up on a hot plate. When using a soldering iron, you can also deform the solder mask. So what I like to do is use this low temperature solder paste, which reflows at around 165 degrees Celsius. I never had any problems with this paste, and I have also managed to use it for transparent PCBs. Those are all the tips I have for you. I hope you learned something from watching this video, and have fun designing your new flexible PCBs. Bye bye! Also, if you want to get super cheesy when working with flexible PCBs, you should definitely get one of my t-shirts.